Good morning, dear students. So children, today we will do 6th chapter of our supplementary English reader book, Footprints Without Feet, entitled The Making of a Scientist. So children, this is one of the best chapters of your book. So since it's not at all a story, first fact you need to know is that it's not at all a story. In fact, it's a kind of, you know, write-up written on the life of a scientist whose name is Richard Ebright. Richard Ebright, so his life has been taken up, how he became a scientist, what factors helped him in making of a scientist, like what were the contributions, what were the problems, what were the frustrations, like all the factors have been included and presented right in front of the readers by Robert W. Peterson. So it's a kind of biography. It means the story of Richard Ebright's life has been described by a writer to make the students understand that how life goes and how goals are achieved in life, how major goals, how long-term goals are set and how those can be achieved. So see, read in the box first what is given to us. Like Richard Ebright has received the Searle Scholar Award and the Scarecrow Award for Biochemistry and Molecular Biology. So it was his fascination for butterflies that opened the world of science to him. So as the title makes you clear that it's the story of a scientist, it's the life of a scientist has been described here, and Richard Ebright is his name. So Ebright received several awards for his scientific achievements because he had a fascination for butterflies. He wanted to explore the world of butterflies, the types of butterflies, their lifestyle, their system. So see, he received major two awards. First is Searle Scholar Award and the Scarecrow Award. So that were for biochemistry and molecular biology. So since he was a science student and you know, his fascination towards the research of butterflies led him to become a famous scientist, right? So see, read and find out the questions. How did a book become a turning point in Richard Ebright's life? So children, a very important fact, very prominent fact would be presented in front of you, that how a single book helped him in turning point, helped him or proved as a turning point in the life of Richard Ebright. It means he read a book or a book became available to him, and how he utilized that book or how that book served as a sort of motivation as well as knowledge in order to open the doors of success to Richard. Second question is, how did his mother help him? Most important question. So the question which I always expect to appear in examination, the contribution of Richard Ebright's mother in his success. Right, so these we would find out while reading the text. So let's read the chapter. At the age of 22, a former scout of the year excited the scientific world with a new theory on how cells work. How cells, I hope you know, cell is the smallest part of our body, right? And a former scout of the year means scout, you know, the people who take NCC, and like scout of the year, like the one who wins scout award. Scout award winner, scout of the year is the student who wins the scout award. So how at the age of 22, a former scout of the year, like how he excited the scientific world with a new theory on, what was the new theory? How cells work, how cells inside the body work, right? Richard H. Ebright was and his college roommate explained the theory in an article in the Proceedings of the National Academy of Science. See children, they explained this theory in an article. So it may be the name of a magazine that is written, since it is in italics, Proceedings of the National Academy of Science. So, who two people contributed? Richard Ebright and his college roommate. His name has not been given here. But these two people explained the theory, and that theory got published as an article in Proceedings of National Academy of Science. I hope that's clear. Next paragraph. So, it was the first time this important scientific journal had ever published the work of college students. So, this is also a very fascinating thing, that it is the first time that this important, that the scientific journal must have been meant for the professors or the research scholars there. But publishing the work of a student must be an outstanding achievement. So was the credit goes to Richard Ebright and his roommate, right? So, next line. In sports, that would be like making the big leagues at the age of 15 and hitting a home run your first time at bat. So children, this is used as an example only. So it has nothing to do with cricket or sports. Making of big leagues means groups of sports clubs or teams like that play matches among themselves. Like we watch IPL. Right? So, leagues are made. It means groups of sports clubs or teams are made and they play matches among themselves. Right? So, Richard Ebright's achievement, his achievement on the working of cell has been compared to the making of big leagues at the age of 15 only. And hitting a home run your first time at bat, that is also a phrase. It means achieving something extraordinary. So, for Ebright, it was the first in a long string of achievements in science and other fields. So, the writer tells us that for Richard Ebright, it was the first string. It means he achieved many more things further in life, but it is the first achievement. It is his first achievement in which field? In the field of science, right? And it all started with butterflies. So, as I told you, as it was also mentioned in the introductory box above given here, that what led him to success, his fascination for butterflies, that he was attracted towards butterflies. That's why he developed so much of the curiosity, so much of enthusiasm to study butterflies and, do a lot of research in that area. Next paragraph. An only child, Ebright grew up north of Reading, Pennsylvania. There wasn't much I could do there, he said. Children, as only child, it means he didn't have any sibling, any brother or sister. He was the only child of his parents, and where he grew up, at the place Reading in Pennsylvania. Reading is the name of a place, right? And he states that there wasn't much I could do there. It means like the place was, like he was so lonely at that place that, he could not do much there. What he could not do, read the next line. I certainly couldn't play football or baseball with a team of one. But there was one thing I could do, collect things. It means, a blessing in disguise. Often the people who say that they live in an area which is in solitude, like their home is in such an area which is in solitude. It means like there is no hustle and bustle, or like there are not much people living in that area, or I don't have any age mates like with whom I can play or spend time with. So same happened with Richard Ebright, but he took the opportunity positively. Like how he took it positively, since there was nobody of his age with whom he could play football or cricket, or these are just an examples, like with whom he could play baseball, football or any other game, because one needs a team. For playing cricket as well, we need at least 11 to 15 people. So, for one team of cricket, one side of cricket, we need these many people. So, here it is written that being alone, he could not play any game, because for playing games, teams are needed. But what he could do alone, he could collect things. It means he had the talent as well as the curiosity to collect things. To collect what? Collect butterflies. So see, So he did and did he ever. It means he always continued his task of collecting butterflies. So see how it all started. Beginning in kindergarten, Ebright collected butterflies with the same determination that has marked all his activities. He also collected rocks, fossils, coins. He became an eager astronomer too, sometimes stargazing all night. It means he was bearing a, you know, curious mind. That was, not with every child. That is not there with every human being. That some people have much curiosity about knowing how and why of things, and that's how they become prominent personalities. That's how they become scientists. So Ebright collected butterflies, but with the same determination, he collected rocks, parts of rocks, fossils, coins. Like, he was as eager as an astronomer, but sometimes he used to look at the sky and kept on gazing, kept on looking at the stars, like, so steadily. His work was to collect various things. It means he wanted to know the existence, he wanted to know the reason of their existence as well as their functioning. So that's why he had that much curiosity about the things. So see, in the next paragraph, what I have explained is just written in a bit difficult language. From the first, he had a driving curiosity along with the bright mind. He also had a mother who encouraged his interest in learning. So see what is written here, that he had a driving curiosity. It means driving doesn't mean to learn how to drive a vehicle. As you know, he had a curiosity which drived him to do a lot many things. Like a pushing curiosity, a curiosity that pushed him from, one place to take up some challenge or have some determination and do something worthwhile in life. So along with, I would like to give you an example here. Like, there are some people who are curious, but, they are mentally not much intelligent. On the opposite hand, there are some people who are very intelligent, but they don't have interest in knowing things. So Ebright was blessed with both these qualities. Like, he had curiosity to know the things. Along with that, he had a brilliant mind as well. Like, he was intelligent as well. So when these two things combine, a person can do wonders as Ebright had done. So see, read the next line, what he has explained here. He also had a mother who encouraged his interest in learning. She took him on trips, brought him telescopes, microscopes, cameras, mounting materials and other equipment, and helped him in many other ways. So I was his only companion until he started school. His mother said, after that I would bring home some friends for him, but at night we just did things together. Richie was my whole life after his father died when Richie was in third grade. A painful personal story has been discussed. So what the writer has narrated here, that Richard Ebright's mother was there to help him at every step. See what she did for him. Like, she used to take him on trips to several places. She brought him telescope, microscope, cameras, and the material which is used for mounting and other equipment. It means other material that helped him in many other ways. So his mother's contribution matters a lot in his success. Like, he has also expressed his gratitude towards his mother, that how without her help, Ebright could not have become a scientist today. So see, she brought him a lot many things, all the equipments, be it cheap or costly. Like, she used to gather all these equipments for him in order to make his study comfortable and smooth. So his mother has also stated that in the next paragraph, that she was his only companion until he started going to school. It means before his school time, his mother was his only friend. It means he had no other friends. And when he made friends, as soon as he entered the school, he began to make friends. But you know, during the daytime, the friends were there in the school, and you know, they used to visit his home as well. But at night time, of course, Richard and his mother, they were alone. Like, nobody was with them since Richard's father expired when he was in third class. So it is described that how, being a single parent, she stood with Richard in all the hard times. Like, how laboriously she took up the task of helping the child by providing him with each and everything along with moral support. I hope that's clear to you. Next paragraph. She and her son spent almost every evening at the dining room table. If he didn't have things to do, I found work for him. Not physical, but learning, his mother said. He liked it, he wanted to learn. And learn he did. He earned top grades in school on everyday things. He was just like every other kid, his mother said. By the time he was in second grade, Ebright had collected all 25 species of butterflies around his hometown, right? So see the following box, what categories he had. His mother has described in third and fourth paragraph that she spent almost all her time with him. So if he didn't have any work to do, she used to make him busy. You know, often it is said that if somebody remains blank, if somebody remains free, their mind works in the opposite direction. The mind works in wrong direction. So in order to avoid Richard to think about anything negative or to think about anything that is wrong or inappropriate at that moment or age, she used to give him lots and lots of work. And she is pleased to inform the readers that he loved that work. You know, there are some children whose mothers keep on pushing them, like, do this work, do that work, learn these questions, cram these, statements. But the children don't listen. But Richard Ebright, on the contrary, he was such a child who used to cram each and everything, who used to understand each and everything. Like, he had such a curiosity that he wanted to learn things. His mother has described that he wanted to learn things and he learned them as well. Like, he used to earn top grades in school. It means he was the topper of the class. But if to talk of everyday things, it means if to talk of other games, sports or like miscellaneous things, co-curricular activities, he was just like other kids. It means he was not much bright or he was not outstanding in other fields, right? But yes, he was brilliant in science, right? So by the time, as he was in the second grade, he had collected how many species? 25 species of butterflies, and all those in his hometown only. See the table as it is written, that species and subspecies of butterflies collected in 6 weeks in reading again. Let me remind you, this is the name of a place. So you know, these are the names. You don't need to remember any name, just know that nymphs are there, satyrs are there, monarchs, whites and sulfurs, snout butterflies are there, winged butterflies are there, brush footed butterflies are there. But you don't need to learn these details, you don't even need to learn the number. You just know that by the time he was in second class, he was able to collect how many species? 25 species. Alright, next paragraph. That probably would have been the end of my butterfly collecting, he said. Now this statement is by Ebright. Richard said that probably means perhaps, that it was the end of his butterfly collecting process. Because around his hometown, only these many butterflies were available. But then my mother got me a children's book called The Travels of Monarch 10. It means this is the same book which the writer talked about. How did the book became a turning point in Richard Ebright's life? It means we will know in the chapter, like, what specifically was there in the book which motivated him, which pushed him so much that he was able to continue his research and become a famous scientist. So see, his research would have been ended, but by then his mother, like he has said, my mother got me a children's book called The Travels of Monarch 10. That book, which told how monarch butterflies migrate to Central America, opened the world of science to the eager young collector. It means it was mentioned in the book that how monarch, it means one of the species of butterflies, I would show you its picture as well, that how monarch butterflies shift to Central America, right? They were living in Reading, Pennsylvania, but how those monarch butterflies shift to Central America, and it was well explained in the book, and the explanation was so fascinating, so attractive, that he developed a curiosity to open the world of science to the people, to do more research in that area and collect more species of these butterflies, right? Next page. At the end of the book, the readers were invited to help study butterfly migrations. So, see, here it is written that when he read that book, at the end of the book, what was given? Readers were invited. It means whosoever read that book, they were given an invitation to help the study of butterfly migrations, that how butterflies migrate, why do they migrate from one place to the other, what is their purpose of going there. They were asked to tag butterflies for research by Dr. Frederick A. Urquhart. So this is a very important name of the University of Toronto, Canada. It means this professor, this researcher, Frederick A. Urquhart from the University of Toronto, Canada, he had asked the learners, the readers of the book, to tag. It means to put a sticker on a butterfly, to tag them in order to ensure the number and the species, to tag butterflies for the purpose of research. So see, Ebright's mother wrote to Dr. Urquhart. It means, see, his mother's role has been very much parallel, almost equal to Richard Ebright. That his mother wrote a letter to doctor, and you know, and soon Ebright was attaching light adhesive tags to the wings of monarchs. Anyone who found a tagged butterfly was asked to send the tag to Dr. Urquhart. So it means Dr. Urquhart had invited the readers in order to get more gathering, more collection of butterflies, and it would also fulfill the interest of people who really wanted to do their own collection, who wanted to satisfy their craze of collecting butterflies. So as she wrote to Dr. Urquhart, and you know, his suggestion was to collect and, you know, tag those butterflies and help in the collection of the same. So see, read the next paragraph. The butterfly collecting season around Reading lasts 6 weeks in late summer. That's why, children, it was written here that, see, 6 weeks. That these are the species which were collected by Richard Ebright in 6 weeks, approximately 1.5 months. So here it is written that the butterfly collecting season, for how long it lasts in Reading place, for 6 weeks, about 1.5 months, right, in late summers. So the graph is given, like the graph explaining the number and kinds of butterflies that were collected in 6 weeks, the names which I told you, gossamer winged, nymphs and satyrs, brush footed, whites and sulfurs, monarch butterflies, snouts, right, and number collected, see, of some he collected 1, of some he collected 10. So here it is given that like if you are young to chase them, sorry, if you are going to chase them one by one, you won't catch them many. It means here Dr. Urquhart had given the guideline, or you may say instruction, that if you will go after, chase mean go after, if you will go after one to one butterfly, so it's very difficult to catch them. Like you would consume much of your time in collecting these. So what was the idea? How to collect them? See, so the next step for Ebright was to raise a flock of butterflies. It means next step, next work or next task that is to be done by Ebright was to raise a flock, to get a group of butterflies. How that can be achieved? See, what he did, he would catch a female monarch, take her eggs, you know,
the process of reproduction. So he would take a female monarch butterfly and extracted eggs out of her and, you know, raised the eggs in the basement through their life circle. Life cycle from egg to caterpillar, from caterpillar to pupa, and from pupa to adult butterfly. You know, that's how it makes that he preserved the eggs till their maturity. And then he would tag the butterfly wings and let them go. For several years, his basement was home to thousands of monarchs in different stages of development. So it means it is written that for many years, the basement where he had kept the butterflies safe, so that became a home to thousands of monarchs. You know, similar species attract one another. So in the, these are, you know, the different number of butterflies that he collected and their categories, along with their categories it is written. Eventually I begin to lose interest in tagging butterflies, so he used to, you know, make them mature and tag them and let them fly. So eventually means by the end, you know, every work become monotonous, it becomes boring. So here also, like, Richard Ebright begin to lose interest in tagging butterflies. Why? There were two reasons. It's tedious and there's not much feedback, Ebright said. In all the time I did it, he laughed, only two butterflies I had tagged were recaptured, and they were not more than 75 miles from where I lived. So the task had become tedious, it has become monotonous, and there was no much feedback, like, to whosoever he wrote, like, he didn't receive like much good remarks. So that's why he began to lose interest in the task of collecting butterflies and tagging them. So what he writes further, that in all the time he did it, he laughed, because only two butterflies were recaptured, like captured for the second time. And, you know, they were very near, not much away from his place, only 75 miles from where he lived. It means from Reading, Pennsylvania, right? So I hope that's clear up to now. Read the next questions. What lesson does Ebright learn when he does not win anything at a science fair? So the mention of science fairs would be there and his participation. What experiments and projects does he then undertake? It means what was the name of his project? What extraordinary thing did he achieve? What are the qualities that go in the making of a scientist? So the second part of chapter starts here. See, then in the seventh grade, he got a hint of what real science is when he entered a county science fair. You know, for the first time, he got an opportunity to enter a county science fair. And when he was in seventh class, you know, he got a hint of what real science is. It means what actually is the meaning of science. Like, he has been doing certain things in vain. He could have explored much more in life. So from here he gets a hint. Let's see what he knows. But he lost here. It is written, entered a county science fair and lost. It was really a sad feeling to sit there and not get anything while everybody else had won something. Ebright said his entry was slides of frog tissues, which he showed under a microscope. His entry was slides of frog tissues. Notice, children, that what did he prepare? If somebody asks you a question, as it is there in the first part as well, that what lesson he learned when he does not win, and, you know, what experiments and projects does he undertake. So what was his project in the science fair? His project was, you know, to show the slides of frog tissues. So that he showed under a microscope. But he realized that whosoever has won, you know, the person who really wanted to win, or the one who had really done great efforts, so if they lose, they want to know the reason behind that. So they also want to meet the winners. They want to, you know the reason behind their victory. So see, what he realized, that the people, the students who have won there in the science fair, they had tried to do real experiments, not simply make a neat display. So their show off was not only neat and clean, but what they did, the people who won, the winners, right? What they did? They had done some real experiments. It means they had practically done something in real. So their task was not to do research, but to do real things. So see if Richard T. Bright takes lesson from these people or he teaches them a lesson. Next paragraph. Already the competitive spirit that drives Ebright was appearing. I knew that for the next year's fair, I would have to do a real experiment, he said. The subject I knew most about was the insect work, which I had been doing in the past several years. You know, what was his area of interest? His area of interest was to study the structure and cells of butterflies. So, you know, already he was developing a sense of competition. Since he was in 7th grade, even the nursery LKG kids these days develop a sense of competition. But, you know, as he was appearing, he knew that in the fair that is, you know, conducted every year, that county science fair. So he knew that in the next year, if he wanted to win, he has to do some real experiment, you know, because he has lost this time and he has got a lesson. So the only area in which he could say that he was perfect was the study of insects, because he has been doing research on the study of insects from several years. So see, next line. So he wrote to Dr. Urquhart for ideas. He wrote to means he wrote a letter to Dr. Urquhart to get his suggestions that how he can win in this as a county science fair. And came back a stack of suggestions for experiments. You know, one do not expect like a big scientist, a doctor would really reply back and send a stack of suggestions. But, you know, Richard E. Bright received hundreds of suggestions from the side of Dr. Urquhart. So, when he wrote a letter to him seeking for his help. So, see, those kept E. Bright busy all through his high school and led to prize projects in county and international science fair. So, the writer tells us that the ideas of Dr. Urquhart were so amazing that Richard Ebright worked on those ideas for several weeks. Like, he worked for much of the time, and it also led him to prize projects were at two places in county as well as international science fairs. It means, as you know, children often compare that he is a university topper or he is a college topper, school topper, or topper in board, he or she has come in merit list. So exactly the same thing, right? So he won at the international level as well, like he won some reward at the international science fair. Next paragraph. For his 8th grade project. So see, this happened when he was in 7th class. In his 8th grade, Ebright tried to find the cause of a viral disease that kills all monarch caterpillars every few years. You know, as he was a butterfly lover, he came to the conclusion, after observation, he came to the conclusion that, you know, nearly all the monarch caterpillars are killed every few years. All the monarch, nearly means almost all the monarch caterpillars. So, those are killed every year due to a viral disease. So, he wanted to do research on that. See, Ebright thought the disease might be carried by a beetle. He tried raising caterpillars in the presence of beetles. I didn't get, any real results, he said. But I went ahead and showed that I had tried the experiment. This time I won. So, see, when he was in 8th class, he tried to find that why monarch caterpillars, they die after a very few years. They have a very short span of time. So he was curious to know about the reason of their death. So he thought that the disease is probably carried out by beetle. And what did he try? He put beetles along with caterpillars. It means he kept them in observation, in collaboration. Like, he kept both the species together. But what did he derive? What result did he derive? He said that I didn't get any real result. It means beetles were not responsible for the death of monarch butterflies. He said, I went ahead and showed that I had tried the experiment and he won. It means he showed in his experiment at the science fair that he has tried to know the reason of death of early death of monarch butterflies, assuming the beetle as the killer. But he has proved that beetle does not kill monarch butterflies. Right? So this was an achievement on his part and it won him a prize as well. Right? I hope that's clear. His science fair project was testing the theory that viceroy butterflies copy monarchs. So children, listen, this is a bit difficult and more important as well. The theory was that viceroys look like monarchs because monarchs don't taste good to birds. You know children, some birds, many birds in fact, eat butterflies and worms. So see, these are the two categories of butterflies. So how is monarch butterfly that is on the top? Monarch butterfly is this one and this is viceroy butterfly. That is different from, bit different from monarch butterflies. So what is written here, that in the next year science fair project, the theory was that viceroy butterflies copy monarchs. And why they copy monarchs? Why they look like monarchs? They change their body to look like monarchs because birds don't eat monarch butterflies. Birds eat viceroy butterflies instead of monarchs. So that's why viceroys try to look like monarch butterflies so that birds should not eat them. I hope the statement is clear. Next line. Viceroys, on the other hand, do taste good to birds. So the more they look like monarchs, less they are to become a bird's dinner. So the line which I told you in explanation, children, as simple as that, that because viceroys taste good to birds, that's why birds look after, sorry, birds go after these viceroy butterflies in order to prepare their food, and viceroys copy monarch butterfly structure so that birds should not be able to find them and, you know, kill them for their food as dinner. Next paragraph. Ebright's project was to see whether in fact birds would eat monarchs. You know, Richard Ebright, being a brilliant child, had a question in his mind that is it really true that viceroy butterflies copy monarchs, or birds distinguish both these categories, or birds like viceroys and birds dislike monarch. So he found that a starling would not eat ordinary bird food. So what he finds, that a starling, it would not eat ordinary bird food. What it would eat? It would eat all the monarchs it could get. So Ebright said later research by other people showed that viceroys probably do copy monarchs. So this project was placed first in the zoology division and third overall in the county science fair. So this was one of the major success of Richard Ebright, in which he proved that, you know, it would eat all the monarchs. You know, there was nothing like birds do not like monarch butterflies. So birds do like monarchs and they kill monarch butterflies for their dinner. And this project, by making this project, he got first prize in zoology division, and in overall science county fair he achieved third position. Right? Second year in high school, Ebright began the research that led to the discovery of an unknown insect hormone. Indirectly, it also led to his new theory on the life of cells. So see, when he was in high school, it was his second year when he began to do the research. And that research led to his discovery of an unknown insect hormone. And you know, indirectly, that led him to his new theory on the life of cells, which was mentioned in the beginning, that when he was 22 years old, he achieved that. So the question he tried to answer was simple. So what was his question? See carefully. What is the purpose of the 12 tiny gold spots on the monarch pupa? So see, everyone assumed that the spots were just ornamental. It means everyone who was working on these kind of monarch butterflies, they assumed that
The spots which monarch pupas have on their body are just for the purpose of decoration. They don't have any such kind of purpose. Ebright said that, but Dr. Urquhart didn't believe it. So, Ebright's opinion was that how it can be assumed anyways. Like, we should have proof of everything, but Dr. Urquhart was with Richard Ebright's views. He also could not believe that these spots are ornamental. So see here, monarch butterflies, these are full-fledged monarch butterflies, the top one. So but here, the before the maturity, these monarch butterflies, before becoming butterflies, these are monarch pupas. And pupas do have tiny spots over their body. So what was the purpose of those spots? So this was the question which Richard Ebright was trying to give answer. So read the next paragraph. To find the answer, Ebright and other excellent science students first had to build a device which showed that the spores were producing a hormone that was necessary for the butterfly's full development. Very important line, in fact, the answer to our question. It means they researched, Richard Ebright and the other companions which he had, the ones who were working with him as science students, they first had to build a device, build an equipment which showed that the spots that are on the body of monarch pupas, those spots were producing a hormone that was mandatory for the growth and full development of butterflies. So see how it was proved that the spots are producing a hormone. The project, it won Ebright first place in the county fair and entry into the International Science and Engineering Fair. So again, that was a milestone in his career. And, as he brought first prize, he got first prize in the county fair. And by achieving that first prize, he also got an entry into the International Science and Engineering Fair. And there he won third prize for zoology. So there were categories again, and in the field of zoology he got third prize. He also got a chance to work during the summer at the entomology laboratory of the Walter Reed Army Research of Institute. So it is famously known as WRAIR, so our Institute of Research, where entomology laboratory was there. So Richard Ebright got a chance to work at that entomology laboratory after achieving third position for zoology in International Science and Engineering Fair. Next paragraph. As a high school junior, Ebright continued his advanced experiments on the monarch pupa. So that year his project won first place at the International Science Fair and gave him another chance to work in the Army Laboratory during the summer. So as simple as that he continued his advanced experiments on the same monarch pupa, and this year his project won first place at the International Science Fair. Previously he had won third place, and that too in the field of zoology only, not in overall science, zoology only. But this time he became successful in achieving his first place at the International Science Fair. And this gave him a chance to work in the Army Laboratory during the summers. So that was really an extraordinary achievement, an outstanding one, which led him to his way in the making of a scientist. Next paragraph. In the senior year, he went a step further. He grew cells from a monarch's wing in a culture and showed that the cells would divide and develop into normal butterfly wing scales only if they are fed the hormone from the gold spots. The project won first place for zoology at the International Fair, and he spent the summer after graduation doing further work at the Army Laboratory and the laboratory of the US Department of Agriculture. So see children, what further he did, like he grew cells from the monarch butterfly's wings in a culture, in a line, and he showed that the cells, they would divide and develop the normal butterfly wing scales when they would develop only if they are fed with the hormones from the gold spots. And you know, this is what he was trying to find out. Like, he showed that the butterfly cells would divide and develop when, if they get feed from the hormones of the gold spots. It means he proved the importance of gold spots. He proved that if gold spots would not have been there over the body of monarch pupa, it would never develop into a full-fledged butterfly. So there he won first place for zoology at international fair. So see, along with that, he got a chance to work in the army laboratory as well and the US Department of Agriculture. The following year, after his freshman year at Harvard University, if Wright went back to the laboratory of the Department of Agriculture and, you know, more work on the hormone from the gold spots. So here it is given that he continued his work on that hormone from the gold spots, and using the laboratory's sophisticated instruments, he was able to identify the hormone's chemical structure. So see here. So up to now, he was only able to identify the physical structure. So now, with the help of those instruments available at the sophisticated, you know, laboratory, he was able to identify the chemical structure of the hormone as well. A year and a half later, during his junior year, E. Bright got the idea for his new theory about cell life, and it came while he was looking at X-ray photos of the chemical structure of a hormone. So see, slowly he is achieving one after the other milestone when he had, you know, made that determination to follow his curiosity. So here he did more work, harder one, and using the instruments that could not be available with him in his country, so he worked abroad. So when he saw these photos, he didn't shout "Eureka" or "I've got it." You know, these are the expressions used by Dr. Urquhart. So, but he believed that along with the findings about insect hormones, the photos actually gave him the answer to one of his biology puzzles. That is, how the cell can read the blueprint of its DNA. So, DNA, I hope you know about it. It's the substance in the nucleus of a cell that controls heredity. You know, it determines the form and function of the cell. DNA determines the form and functioning of the cell, and thus you can say that it's the blueprint for life. So it's the structure. E. Bright and his college roommate, so his name is given here, James R. Wong, they people worked all that night drawing pictures and constructing plastic models of molecules to show how it could all happen, that how the hormones develop from the gold spots on the body of monarch pupa, and how without the help of those that producing of those hormones from the those gold spots, a butterfly cannot develop to its full structure. So together they wrote the paper that explained the theory. Wrote the paper means they wrote research paper explaining their theory of that gold spots present on the body of monarch pupa, right? So, surprising, no one knew him. Richard E. Bright graduated from Harvard University with highest honors, you know, second in the class of 1510. So, see, a very brilliant task, an outstanding achievement that he stood second in a class of 1510 at Harvard. So, E. Bright went on to become a graduate student researcher at Harvard Medical School, and there he began doing experiments to test his theory. So this was a big motivation for him, and it led the way to his success directly. So if the theory proves correct, it will be a big step towards understanding the processes of life. So, you know, it might also lead to new ideas for preventing some kinds of cancer and other diseases prevalent among the species. And all of this is possible because of E. Bright's scientific curiosity. His high school research into the purpose of the spots on a monarch pupa eventually led him to his theory about cell life. You know, children, I told you in the beginning as well that he had curiosity to know about things. He had that intelligent mind to fulfill his, knowledge, gathering knowledge about his curiosities. So it was a big step towards understanding the process of life, that how life is generated, how hormones are important. So his high school research into the purpose of spots on that I told you on the body of monarch pupa. So eventually that motivated him to work on his theory about cell life. So Bright has been interested in science since his first, he first began collecting butterflies, but not so deeply as he has not time for other interests. E. Bright also became a champion debater and public speaker and a good canoeist, all-round outdoors person. He is also an expert photographer, particularly of nature and scientific exhibits. See, a list of achievements means it cannot be said that if a person is expert in one field, he cannot do other tasks perfectly. So there's a list of his interests as well as his hobbies, that how he could do, how he was multitasking, how he could do or handle so many tasks being a scientist. So see, he has been interested in science, that was his in first place, that he was very much interested in collecting butterflies, but not so deeply, but yes, means his major interest was science, his deep interest was science, but his other interests did also exist, and that he was a champion debater. It means he was an expert in debate, as well as he was a very good public speaker. He was a good canoeist, canoeing especially in the areas of Himachal, etc., that we see, and all-round outdoor person he was. Next, besides these things, he was an expert photographer. Particularly, he was interested in taking the photographs of nature and scientific exhibitions. Right? Next paragraph. In the high school, Bright was a straight A student. Because learning was easy, he turned a lot of his energy towards the debating and Model United Nations clubs. MUNs, Model United Nations, MUN clubs are there in some of the schools right these days. So, in these clubs, students are well taught the skills to have a debate. So, Model MUN. So, a Model United Nations or MUN, these are called. So, because learning was easy, so that's why, he had a brilliant mind, and for him, learning was very easy. So, he got a good lot of time to spend on other skills, like his debating skills. So, what he found next, he also found someone to admire his interest, that is Richard A. Verrier, that was his social studies teacher. So, who was that admirer? That admirer was his social studies teacher, Mr. Richard A. Verrier. He was a teacher as well as advisor to both the clubs. So, Verrier was the perfect person for me, then he opened my mind to new ideas, E. Bright said. It means he has also mentioned the contribution of his social studies teacher in the development of his interests and hobbies for debating. So, see, Richard would always give that extra effort, Mr. Verrier said. What pleased me was, here was this person who put in 3 or 4 hours at night doing debate research besides doing all his research with butterflies and his other interest. So, one of very, very important things that come out here, that comes out from the statement of his social studies teacher, Mr. Verrier, that Richard was so devoted, he was so sincere, that apart from his research of butterflies and other science projects, he would spend a lot of time, he would spend at least 3 to 4 hours extra time to debating skills. Means he used to do a task with such interest, right? So, next paragraph. Richard was competitive, Verrier continued. His teacher said that he had that sense of competition. That's why, children, he won so many prizes at the county as well as international science fairs. So, because he had developed a sense of competition, right? So, but not in a bad sense. It means he was never jealous or envious of anybody. He just wanted to grow. He explained, Richard wasn't interested in winning for winning's sake or winning to get a prize. Rather, he was winning because he wanted to do the best job he could. For the right reasons, he wants to be the best.
you know, he wanted to have knowledge. A concept not same, I would say, but similar to the one that is displayed in the movie Three Idiots, that the desire is not to be first. The desire is to get that much knowledge that stands at the top, that one stands distinguished. So this was the dream of Richard. And that is one of the ingredients in the making of a scientist. See, the answer to all of your questions, that all these are the things that are required in becoming a scientist. You know, to follow a task, peeche pad jana kisi kaam ke buri tarah, that you spend a lot and lot of time there. Like, start with the first rate mind. So that is a revision. That how one can become a scientist, or how he became a scientist, he started with a first-rate mind, curiosity, mix in the will to win for the right reasons. So he had all these qualities. He had first-rate mind, means he was very brilliant, very intelligent mind. He had curiosity in it, and mix in the will. You know, will is very important. There are people who are brilliant, but they don't want to do anything. There are people who want to do something, but they don't have those resources or intelligent mind. Richard had all these things, and he had the curiosity to follow his dreams. So Richard, you know, from the time the book, The Travels of Monarch 10, opened the world of science to him, Ebright has never lost his scientific curiosity. It means he was one of those people who, you know, take up a task, not for the sake of completing it, but for the sake of their own development. They do tasks so that they can grow. They can satisfy their, you know, curiosities. They can satisfy their interests of knowing the things in a much, much better manner. So all these are the ingredients in the making of a scientist. All these are the things that are required for making of a scientist. Right. I hope you are very much clear with the lesson, and do the back exercise question and leave the queries in the comment section. I'll be happy to take that. Happy learning. Thank you.